Now, as we continue to track the plaque, you're about to see how dangerous bacteria living in the mouth can affect more than just the teeth. Consider this shocking fact. The human mouth can contain up to 700 different kinds of bacteria.
50% of the number of bacteria present in the body is present in the mouth.
Good bacteria in the mouth do things like heal wounds. The bad kind live in plaque that can harden into tartar, harming our teeth and our gums. To demonstrate, Dr. Nabil Basada removes a piece of plaque from my mouth.
I'm going to take it here and I put it on this slide. This is a very small amount of plaque, and then we are going to put it under the microscope, just a higher power, to see what is in it.
Under the microscope, we see different shaped creatures squirming and crawling. Keep in mind, such creatures live in all our mouths, but in my mouth, some bad ones have overtaken the good.
Well, the long filament one is like a worm. It looks like a
wiggly worm. Exactly like a worm.
That's the bad kind.
That's bad.
How afraid should I be that all that's in my mouth, alive, swimming?
Well, it's not a good thing to have that stuff in the mouth, because you put yourself at a risk. You don't need that.
Those bad bacteria can be the start of gingivitis, the earliest stage of gum disease, in which gums appear red, swollen, and bleed easily.
As we go around the tooth, I want to make sure that we're within that green band.
Okay. To check for gum disease, doctors use a ruler instrument. As pockets of inflammation get bigger, so does the space between the teeth and gums.
So I'm down into about 4 millimeters here, and that's starting to get what we would call a pocket.
The bad bacteria is underneath those.
Yeah, the bacteria starts on the tooth surface, and then the bacteria starts to creep to reach under the gum.
Here's what advanced gum disease looks like. If the infection reaches the jawbone, the teeth can fall out. Gum disease now surpasses decay as the number one cause of tooth loss among adults. The bacteria that causes it can wreak havoc in other parts of the body as well. For years, doctors have known that bleeding gums can allow bad bacteria to get into the bloodstream and cause infections. That's why people with certain prosthetic devices, like heart valves or replacement knees, have to take antibiotics before having dental work. The danger of traveling bacteria is also why people slated for major surgery, like heart bypass, must first take care of all their dental problems.
Ed, have a look, please.
But recent research conducted here at Case Western Reserve University School of Dental Medicine now shows that chronic inflammation associated with gum disease is another source of trouble.
So gum disease equals inflammation, and inflammation spells trouble for the rest of the body.
Toxins associated with inflammation contribute to the formation of clots that can lead to heart attacks and strokes, so-called hardening of the arteries. Having gum disease puts you at a substantially higher risk for having heart disease. Dr. Basada thinks it may even trump high cholesterol.
In my experience, that inflammation coming from periodontal or gum disease is of more significance or plays more of a role in heart attacks or heart disease than high cholesterol level.
70-year-old Donald Nemeth has both gum and heart disease.
What amazes me is that the plaque buildup in your teeth can affect your body health to degrees I never could imagine.
Here's another example. It's long been known that poorly managed diabetes increases the risk of having gum disease. Now new research shows the relationship is a two-way street. Diabetics who take good care of their gums may have an easier time managing their diabetes.
If you treat gum disease, your blood sugar level becomes lower too.
I doubt that hardly anyone knows that doing good dental care is going to help you with diabetes.
There is evidence, too, that gum disease can also play a role in some cases of premature delivery or stillbirth. Dr. Raymond Redline is one of the few placenta pathologists in the world. He examines the tissue samples taken from the placentas, which are the afterbirths from mothers who give birth to premature or stillborn babies. Stand by, because now we're going into the pathology lab. Be advised, some of the footage gets a little graphic.
When you break your bag of waters, this is the bag of waters.
This bag holds the amniotic fluid, which together with the placenta nourish the growing fetus and act as a protective barrier. A barrier that in a few cases, oral bacteria has now been found to infiltrate.
You have been able to find that the oral bacteria from the mouth crossed in through that bag of membranes? That's where they cross?
That's right. They can either cross the placenta itself and go directly into the baby, or they can go into the bag of membranes and cause an infection that triggers labor and leads to preterm delivery.
Proof of such transmission came from the work of Dr. Yiping Han, who developed a special DNA test to show that bacteria taken from the mouth of a mother who delivered a stillborn matched the bacteria found in the placenta.
What we showed was really the first case in the live human being that this really can happen. And so it's a proof of concept, and it's really a very important step in our pursuit.
Bleeding gums, so-called pregnancy gingivitis, is common. And contrary to the old wives' tale that pregnant women should stay away from the dentist, expectant mothers, just like everyone else, need regular dental care and need to brush and floss. In the future, as more research is conducted, there may be more specialized interventions designed for pregnant women in gum care.
Well, I think it's early in the game, and I think as we accumulate more data on what that oral microenvironment in the mouth becomes during pregnancy, we'll be able to more specifically target either organisms or the care that we provide to change that.